Good morning. Good morning, Sister Drayton. Good morning, Sister Dishman. Good morning, everybody. Happy Sunday. Good morning. Good morning, Sister Betty Campbell. I'm going to go ahead and get started this morning, you all. I've got a request that came to us. And so I'm going to go ahead and start playing this. This came from Sister Phyllis Smith. And I am going to go ahead and play her request. It is none other than the late, great James Cleveland. Everyone, good morning and happy Sunday. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We bring you greetings from the Berkeley Mount Zion Baptist Church, and we are in about 12 or 13 minutes getting ready for virtual Sunday school. And until then, we are playing some great gospel oldies. And that first song was by James Cleveland, and that was called One More Time, and that was requested by Sister Phyllis Smith. All right, here's one of my favorites, y'all. So I'm going to go ahead and play this, and then we've got another request that came from someone. But let me go ahead and do this one really quickly. And yeah, we've got some great songs. This was one of my favorite songs right here. I always say that about every song, right? Here we go, right here. It's one of my very favorites. None other than the very one and only, the late, great Danny Bell Hall. And I'm just going to play after this. All right. You know, we're going to add to go. That's not the song, but yeah. It's coming up. And here we go. Love this. Morning, Sister Curry. Good morning, Catherine Thompson. Here we go. Listen to the show.
Just ordinary people. God uses ordinary people.
Cleveland, one more time. Did you all see my singing face when you like do this? I was like, that means I was really feeling that. That's kind of my singing face. All right, we've got one more request. This request goes out to one of my favorite people, Sister Gladys Anderson. She called me and said, Brother Steve, I have a request. And I said, Sister Gladys, I will be absolutely thrilled to play your request. And I was like, oh, right now. And she threw up kind of an old one that I kind of like. And so, Sister Gladys Anderson, this is for you. Thank you for calling. Thank you for your request. And it's going to make a few people shout. Okay, Sister Betty Campbell, go ahead and take your seat, because I know you're going to be up on this one. All right? But this is a great one. It's by the Williams Brothers, you all.
Verizon 5G is here with a coverage of 5G nationwide and in more and more cities.
Here we go. Kind of quartet-ish.
I like that, y'all.
I like it too. I like that, y'all. Oh, yeah. Good morning, Sister Grant.
Heartaches, I've had my share of heartaches.
What do you say, what?
But I'm still here.
There's that singer face again. Ooh. Watch this.
Trouble, I've seen my share of trouble.
Singer face.
But I'm still here. I'm still here.
And a lot of folks said that I wouldn't be here tonight.
Gladys Anderson, that was for you, and that was the Williams Brothers singing Still Here. Before that was Danny Bell Hall, Ordinary People, and before that was James Cleveland, One More Time. And I know what you're thinking. You say, Brother Steve, you didn't do your tambourine this morning. Hold on, because at the end, I've got one more song, and yes, that tambourine's coming out. You know, that tambourine is, that's my best friend now, and I'm getting better. Tell me, I'm getting better with that tambourine. So let me begin by saying good morning to each of you. It's 9 o'clock, and this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I bring you greetings from the Berkeley Mount Zion Baptist Church, located at 1400 8th Street in the city of Berkeley, where the Reverend Brian D. Hunter is our pastor and teacher. I guess our location is now, we're meeting you virtually. This is our virtual Sunday Learning Institute, also known as Sunday School. And this is an opportunity for people to get together and study the lesson that has been provided for us. We are studying the book of Exodus. And for the last month or so, we've been talking about the plight of the children of Israel. And so the first unit that we covered really was entitled Provisions, and was showing just as the children of Israel were exiting from Egypt, it was talking a lot about God's provisions and just a reminder to all of us just how God continues to provide for us. Amen. And I again emphasize how we sometimes take those things for granted, that God continues to provide for us. And things, whether it be shelter, whether it be food, whether it's our health, just being in our right mind, we thank God for His provisions. And now, in Unit 2, we've been studying God's instruction. And so, for the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about how the children of Israel were receiving instructions. And even last week, we kind of highlighted the Ten Commandments. And so today, we're dealing with God confirms the covenant. And that's going to be kind of our lesson today. But before that, let's go ahead and begin with a word of prayer. Amen. Father in heaven, how we thank you for this another day. We thank you for the gift of a brand new day. And for this, we want to say thank you. We thank you, Father, for just your mercy and your grace and for allowing us to see another day. Father, how we are grateful, and Lord, we just acknowledge that you are God and beside you there's no other. We thank you for the opportunity to study your word. We thank you, Father, for an opportunity to apply those things to our lives, that we may walk worthy to be called your children. Father, we just thank you for instruction. We thank you for those who have come together virtually, and we just again, Father, ask for your guidance. Open up our hearts and minds that we might get an understanding of thy word. Now let me decrease, that thou might increase, that something might be said to challenge, to uplift, and to encourage those who are listening today. We thank you for the opportunity and the privilege. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you again, everyone, so much. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, Sister Angela and Sister Ada. Thank you so much for tuning in to each of you. Again, my name is Steve Gardner, and I'm have been the a facilitator or Sunday school teacher for the last couple of months. And again, let me just say how what is my privilege and my privilege to be sharing with you all these Sunday mornings. Actually, I look forward to it as kind of we gather, and it's just an opportunity and a privilege to be able to do so. Let me just say a couple of quick announcements, and I'll re-emphasize these again. Everyone knows how important it is to vote. You should have received a ballot in the mail. And again, if you are physically unable to take your ballot to the mailbox, you may call the church and they will make arrangements to pick up your ballot and get it mailed to you. But the most important thing is that we vote. Amen. So please, ma'am, please, sir, make sure that you take advantage of the opportunity and the privilege, particularly as people of color, how this is such a privilege for us. Lives were lost that we might have the opportunity to vote. So we don't want to take that lightly. And so thank you all so very much. And again, we are just excited to be continuing to study out of the book of Exodus. And Exodus is the second book of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus. And again, Exodus, again, has a lot to do with the migration of the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt under the rulership of Pharaoh. And so we've been talking a lot about just how the children of Israel continue to fall into kind of a back and forth in terms of worshiping idols or being disobedient. And so God has given them instruction under the leadership of his servant Moses. And so many of us know the story of Moses and have captured the, remember the book of Moses and the book of, and the story of the Ten Commandments through where to be learning it in Sunday school or vacation Bible school, or even learning it, learning and picking up pieces from the great movie that was, oh boy, it must be, what, 40, 50 years old? Starring Charlton Heston as Moses. But it was a great, great star-studded cast of the Ten Commandments. It's a great movie. And I know it comes on every year. Is it around Christmas or Easter? I think that's kind of when it plays. And I, again, continue to love it. That's one of my favorite movies of all time. All right, we are again in the 24th book of the book of Exodus, the 24th book of Exodus. And again, we are just after receiving the Ten Commandments, the children of Israel are dealing with what's taking place. So let's get a little bit of lesson background, if you will. So after the children of Israel arrived at Mount Sinai, God gave them a set of laws and regulations to live by once they entered the promised land. So remember, the children of Israel are camped down at the base of Mount Sinai. And this is the place where God has spoken to Moses to give Moses the instructions. And those instructions included the Ten Commandments. These laws concerning testimonies and speech reveal that there will always be a need for honesty and compassion. Amen. While camped at Mount Sinai, God made a conditional covenant with his people. So when a covenant is an agreement between two parties, and, you know, when we think about a covenant and thinking about an agreement, we do that in a number of ways. I'm thinking about when I bought my home in 1992 or 93, and that was a real scary time, because those of you who have had the experience of purchasing a home, there are just 1,000 pieces of paper that you sign, and you're signing, and you're signing, and you're signing. And so this agreement or contract you are signing is saying that it is conditional. It is conditional that you pay what you agree, because if you don't, then the covenant or agreement is broken. But I do remember having the experience of feeling overwhelmed because all of the signing and the documents, and you know, you're trying to read everything, but as most of you know, it is just, you know, lots and lots of pages of documents, and they're telling you, sign here, this says here, this says here. But basically what the agreement is that if you say that by signing here, you are entering a contract by saying that you will pay this amount of money, you know, every month, and if you do so, you will be allowed to stay or occupy this residence. Then again, that's a conditional covenant, because if you fail to pay, then the covenant, the contract is broken, and that they will take measures to have you removed from that place. Amen. So I thought about a covenant and a contract, and one that really comes to mind, that from my own experience, that was quite intimidating, was, you know, the purchase of a home. Amen. All right, so let's continue. Good morning, Sister T and Carmen. While camped at Mount Sinai, God made a conditional covenant with his people. God made both unconditional and conditional covenants with his people. So when God makes covenants, sometimes they're conditional, which means it really means that when they're conditional, they usually say, if you do this, then he will do this. And then sometimes there's unconditional covenants, and I'll explain in a minute. In an unconditional covenant, God was the only one responsible for keeping it. So in an unconditional covenant, God will say something like, I will. So he is saying that this is what he will do. That's an unconditional covenant, that regardless, it's, God is the only one responsible for keeping that in, because it is unconditional, that he will do. And one thing I love about God is that God does not lie. Amen. We can always depend on him to keep his end of the bargain. Amen. Or the covenant. So in an unconditional covenant, God says, I will, meaning he's the only one obligated to the covenant. In a conditional covenant, God says, I will if you will. Amen. So in a conditional covenant, it really is, I will if you will. And I thought about, you know, one of the very famous verses in the Bible that has to do with kind of conditional is 2 Chronicles 7:14. It's a very familiar passage of scripture that many people are familiar with, and we kind of quote it a lot. And it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. And again, conditional, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. So the condition is, if my people who are called by name will do what? Will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then, here's the condition, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Amen. So that's conditional. Amen. It is something that both parts must do. So part of that kind of helps us understand that. So both parties must keep the agreement. This was a conditional covenant that God gave to the children of Israel. Both parties play a part in keeping it. If one party broke it, the other party was not obligated to keep their part. This particular covenant that we've been covering is what's called the Mosaic Covenant. Mosaic, M-O-S-A-I-C, Mosaic Covenant, presented in this lesson. The Israelites agreed to obey God and keep his commandments. Amen? And if they did, God said they would be a peculiar treasure to him above all other people. They would also be kingdom priests. And this was the foundation of the Mosaic Covenant. It was the foundation of the Mosaic Covenant. Following the institution of the covenant with his people, God gave what we know as the Ten Commandments. And again, the Ten Commandments was the foundation. And again, those commandments continue to provide us with a foundation of how, one, we relate to God, and two, how we relate to one another. Amen. And those particular commandments, the majority of them are what we consider prohibitions. They say, thou should not do this, don't do this, don't steal, don't kill, don't lie, Don't bear false witness. That's it. Don't covet. So many of those covenants have to do with telling us what we should be prohibiting from doing. Amen. And then there are those covenants that identify our relationship to God, like not to worship false idols. Again, those Ten Commandments were given to Moses and the children of Israel. Moses then came near to the Lord, whose appearance was in a thick cloud. Amen. We saw that. And then God gave Moses additional laws covering much of Hebrew life. Amen. Including laws regarding master and servant relationships, laws regarding personal injuries, laws regarding rights to property. So along with the Ten Commandments, there were additional laws that were given. And much of that was conveyed to Moses. And again, Moses began to make sure that he recorded these. And again, we have the Word of God that one is something that we can read, something. And again, one of the reasons why these laws were written and they were recorded, in the case of dispute, can be very clear when taking a look at it. So it's not, let me try to remember what was said, but because it was written, it allows one to get clarity and to get making sure that they understand clearly what the word says. Amen. So this kind of brings us to the 24th. And today's lesson really is God confirms the covenant. So there, and in today's lesson, it is a really interesting ceremony, a series of ceremonies, a series of things that take place in this confirmation of the covenant, and that's kind of where we're late to today. And so part of that ceremony that as we look at today has to do with sealing and preserving the covenant. And so part of, in the 24th chapter that we look at today, is going to cover much of that. It really is saying, here's the law, now we're going to both parties agree that we are going to confirm that this covenant is between God and his people. And so there's a ceremony of sealing that's going to take place. And we'll see this. It's kind of interesting. And there are a number of things that take place in this ceremony. There's kind of pillars of stone that represent the 12 tribes of Israel. There's kind of an offering and sacrifice, kind of the blood that was shed, an animal sacrifice. And this was oftentimes done kind of as a showing sacrifice and again, redemption for sin. And so that was very, very common, where a animal was offered up, the blood of the animal was offered up. And so we know that symbolically, that is what the price that Jesus paid, his blood was offered. He became the living sacrifice that we might have eternal life. Amen. So we no longer have to do the animal sacrifices, because Jesus provided the ultimate sacrifice by giving his life. Amen. So there was offering and sacrifices, and then there was blood that was sprinkled. We'll see that kind of was interesting to me, that blood was sprinkled and used in religious ceremony, emphasizing the sacredness of life. There was the actual reading of the covenant. So the reading of the covenant was also part of this ceremony. And then it concluded with a covenant meal. Amen. It concluded with a covenant meal. And so this is where the text takes us. It takes us to this particular portion of the 24th chapter. All right. I kind of made some notes here, and I wanted to share this with you as I was going through. You know, a covenant was sealed by solemn oaths in which each party called down retribution upon his own head if he broke the agreement. Amen. These oaths were sealed in blood, and that's kind of what we'll see today. The blood thrown on the altar symbolized God's oath, while that blood that was thrown or sprinkled on the people symbolized their oath. Amen. And the animal shed blood was proof that one's life. So again, historically, animals were offered up as a sacrifice for sin. And so the blood was kind of what was given. And again, we no longer do that, because Jesus became the living sacrifice. His blood was shed that we might have a right as believers today. Amen. And Lord, we thank God for his only begotten son that became a living sacrifice that we might have. And somebody said the ultimate sacrifice. Amen. He became the ultimate sacrifice. All right, so here is, we begin in the 24th chapter of the book of Exodus, and we're going to be taking a look at this particular series of ceremony or events that took, that's taken place. Now remember, the Ten Commandments have already been given. God has also given Moses some additional instructions, some additional laws pertaining to life and property and things. So now that they have come to this point, here is where the covenant is sealed. It's kind of signed off. I mean, both parties agree, and here's what takes place. And this is where our text picks up. In the 24th book of Exodus, in the first verse, it says, "And he said unto Moses, Come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu." These were Aaron's sons. "And 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off." So God has calling Moses along with Aaron, who again will become very significant in terms of leadership, and then Aaron's two sons, who we'll discover later on became very disobedient, and as a result were killed in later on. But at this particular point, God is asking Moses to come along with Aaron, Aaron's two sons, and then 70 of the elders. And remember, these elders represented the 12 tribes of Israel. And so the elders are now asked to come. However, God has made it very clear that Moses is the only one that has been given permission to approach and to be close enough. Not so close, but close enough where God says that that's close enough. Where the others have been instructed to stand kind of afar off. Amen? And that's kind of what it says here. The elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off. Amen? You can worship, but we want you to worship. God says we want you to worship afar off. The second verse says, "And Moses alone," so God says, "and Moses alone shall come near the Lord, but they shall not come nigh." So he's saying Moses can come forward, but they shall not come nigh. "Neither shall the people go up with him." All right? So God is giving clear instructions about what he wants to happen. And this, at this particular time, Moses is coming forward. And at this particular time, Moses, Aaron and Aaron's sons also, and then some of the elders, 70 of the elders to be exact, also come through. All right? And here's the third verse. Amen. "And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments." Let me just stop there for a moment. It is important that, as Moses did with the children of Israel, that we are also responsible to make sure that we share the good news of the gospel. So part of this we want to take away is, you know, those of us who have yeah, children, that one of our responsibilities as parents is to share God's story, is to teach and train up our children so that they will be very clear about the ways of the Lord. Amen. And not only with our children, but when we have the opportunity to share the word of God, that's something that as believers we ought to do. So that people ought to see in us the life of Christ. Amen. And so part of that is we want to be witnesses. We want to be a living testimony of the love of God. People ought to see something in us. "And Moses came," this is the third verse, "and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord hath said will we do." So they're confirming that, yes, they're saying, yes, we will obey. And if you think about it, you know, how could they not, after all that God has shown them by his protection, by his provisions, that God was faithful in allowing them to escape the rulership of Pharaoh and allow the children of Israel to leave, and then leading them to the promised land. And here now, God in all of his glory, in his majesty, has now allowed confirmation of the covenant. Amen. So a confirmation of the covenant. Amen. I love that part. It just kind of reminds me of the awesomeness and the majesty of God. He's just, he's so worthy to be praised. He is so worthy of our praise and worship. And just every time we get a chance, we ought to just say, Lord, I just want to thank you. Lord, I just thank you. And again, folks, I think about the things that we take for granted. You know, I can come and turn this light switch on. And, you know, we take those little things for granted. And so, Lord, I just thank you for how you continue to provide and how you continue to allow us. And again, one of my favorite things that I'm so grateful for, working in a health field, one is for health. But I just, Lord, thank you for helping me to wake up in my right mind. Amen. I just like that saying, Lord, in my right mind. I see driving along the streets and then people who just are, don't know who they are. And they just don't know, you know, where they are and how fortunate we are that God allows us to be in our right mind. Amen. And I'm just grateful for that. And I love when Pastor Hunter always talks about how much we ought to just give God the glory and praise. Amen. And so that is a wonderful, wonderful opportunity for us to continue to say, Lord, we thank you. All right. So here we go. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord. I'm in the fourth verse. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord and rose up early in the morning and built an altar under the hill and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. So Moses, again, got up, rose up and built an altar. And these altars were these stones of pillars, where he said, and they represented the 12 tribes of Israel. Stone monuments or structures were set up as shrines to the gods, and Moses used 12 pillars, one for each of 12 tribes. All right, so that's kind of part of this whole ceremony process, was building an altar. Amen. All right, and here we go, the fifth verse. And he sent young men of the children of Israel, which offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen unto the Lord. And again, this is where oftentimes, historically, the animals were offered as sacrifices for our sins. And so, again, we understand today as believers that it's not necessary. We don't go and get dogs and cats and cattle and horses to do that, because Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice. He shed his blood that we might have a right to eternal life. And so that symbolism back at that time, that act was an act that was very common. It was very part of the practice. But again, we understand now today that because of the ultimate sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross, that he bore our sins that we might have a right. Amen. And that's just, praise God, shouting news. Shouting news, amen. So I love that. All right. So these young men were children of Israel, offered up burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen unto the Lord. All right. Now, and this is kind of where it gets kind of interesting, where the blood was sprinkled kind of on the altar and on the people. I just thought it was kind of interesting, you know, because most of us like blood. Oh, you know, when we see blood, we're like, bad. And in this day and age, because of kind of disease, we're often, you know, we're also told about universal precautions. And so it's one of those things that it just sounds very interesting. But from a historical point of view, it helps us understand that. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and half of the blood he sprinkled on the altar. All right. And he took the book of the covenant and read in the audience of the people. And they said, all that the Lord said we will do, and be obedient. Amen. So the people, as part of this, are confirming that they will do what thus said the Lord. Amen. Sounds like us sometimes, right? We always, Lord, I send me, Lord, I'll go. You know, and we have to be very careful when we say, Lord, let your will be done. Lord, here I am, send me. You know, and we say, wait now, Lord, I didn't mean there. Lord, send me to someplace comfortable and someplace nice. Right? So we oftentimes have to be very careful the vows, the words that we say. But Lord, I just, you know, And oftentimes when we ask God for things, we think we oftentimes want to dictate how those things are given to us. And so when we ask God for patience, it doesn't mean that he just magically says, okay, here you go, you got it, you wake up tomorrow, you're going to be patient. Sometimes we have experiences that God allows us to go through. Sometimes it might be a trial that we have to experience that helps us learn patience. Amen? So just because we ask for something doesn't mean we determine how it's given to us, how God provides for us, because he may, and I love this about God, to say he knows what's best for me. You know, when people say he's better to me than I've been to myself, he knows what's best. And so trusting him to learn that if we ask for something, he may give it to us in a way that we have to have an experience about it. And so I'm learning, folks, that in my spiritual maturity, that I want, I don't simply, when I'm going through something, I don't simply ask God, like, why? But Lord, what's the lesson for me? Amen. So if I'm going through something, I said, Lord, what's the lesson for me? Because I believe that there's a lesson in this. And the most important piece is I want to be able to get the lesson. Amen. I want to be able to make sure that if I go through the school of hard knocks, I want to make sure that I don't have to go through it more than once in terms of lessons. But I want to learn the lesson. Amen. Moses began to read the covenant as a reminder, because sometimes we have to be reminded. So let's stop there. One of the things that's extremely important, and we thank and praise God for those of you who are tuning in, because part of our responsibility is to be able to learn and understand what thus saith the Lord. We are really understanding a lot of history, but we certainly want the application to be launched today, that we learn and study the Word of God, that we read it, we take it in, we digest it, we listen to it. When pastor teaches us, and through studying the Word of God, when we hear messages from pastor and other ministers, we are ingesting and taking in the Word of God in a way that allows us to apply it, because the most important piece is that we apply it. I'm always very careful when somebody, not careful, I'm always mindful, I should say, when somebody says, oh, Brother Steve, good lesson, or if, oh, Pastor, great message. And my initial response is, so what did you do with it? If it just becomes another good message, you just shelve it and that's it. But what's the lesson? What's the application for you? And that's really why we study God's Word, and we read it, and we comprehend it, and most important, that we apply it, that we practice it, we rehearse it, you know? So we have an opportunity to rehearse, to practice what we learn in a way that allows us to become familiar, so it becomes a part of our daily routine, our daily practice, our daily life, amen? So practicing that is an important piece. So learning the Word of God, and I like that somebody says, lessons in life's journey. Amen. And so the children of Israel was having this experience, but we also have an experience of learning life's lessons in life's journey. Amen. And so here we go in the 8th verse. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord hath made with you concerning all these words. So in this ceremony, there was sprinkling on the altar, and then sprinkling the blood on the people. Yeah. Now, I have to admit, it kind of sounds like, ooh, blood. They're like, ugh. But this was a practice. This was something that was done to seal the covenant. Amen. Amen. I know this. It sounds a little squeamish. You know, I can imagine, you know, blood is one of those things we're like, ugh. However, we know symbolically how important that is. Amen. And that blood, the shedding of the blood of Jesus was so important. He shed his blood for me. Amen. Just think that. Think about that. How that Jesus, when he was on the cross, was on my behalf. And I take it personal that he was thinking, this is for Steve Gardner. This is for Esther Gaston. This is for Betty Campbell. This is for Angela Dorsey. This is for Maxine Charles and Carmen Foster. That he was doing so for us. He died that we might have a right. His blood was shed on our behalf. And that ought to just give us, oh man, just an appreciation and to worship him. And to, he's so worthy of our praise. He's so worthy of our adoration and our worship. Amen. All right. So the ninth verse says, then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, these were the sons of Aaron, and 70 of the elders of Israel. So they're coming up, but not close, remember. Moses was the only one that was allowed to get close enough based upon how God. Now the elders in them were able to see part of what we understand in this last verse, not God directly, but an image. And they were actually to see the base. And it says, and they saw the God of Israel, and there was under his feet. So they kind of were able to see this part, as it were a paved work of a sapphire stone, and as it were the body of heaven in his clearness. So just imagine, the elders were able to see this image, if you will, and they were able to see kind of the a stone and sapphire stone that really represented the majesty of God. Wow, that's just, I think about it, like, it just had to be an experience that I'm sure was unforgettable to have that experience. You know, we sometimes have experiences in our life that we don't forget, and there are experiences that we just thank and praise God for. I shall never forget the birth of my daughter. That was an experience that was life-changing for me, amen? It was an experience that was life-changing. A little scary, but it was an experience that was life-changing, and it's unforgettable. We also have these same kinds of experiences today as believers. And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. Also, they saw God and did eat and drink. And so the ceremony was concluded with a covenant meal. Amen. It's always something, you know, folks are always going to eat. Amen. We're always going to look having a way to eat. And eating, if you think about it, has a lot of symbolism and a lot of things that we do kind of in terms of custom. And eating has become a part of our culture. It has become a part of a lot of customs that we do. You know, we celebrate, you know, when things happen, we eat. at times of grief, one of the things that we do, you know, after people come together is what we eat. We have a repast. Eating tends to allow a lot of social the people to come together, and it's a very social, very soothing thing, and most people enjoy. We enjoy eating, amen. And so here in the covenant meal was sealed and confirmed with a covenant meal, amen. And so in those verses 1 through 11 is the context of our lesson today, that God confirms his covenant. So God confirms his covenant. And again, we're talking about in this unit, we're talking about instruction of how God continues to provide instruction. He continues to provide an opportunity for us to learn about him. And so in any relationship that you're in, you've got to spend time together, amen. And that doesn't change with our relationship with God, is that God wants us to spend time with him. You know, and sometimes I think, boy, did I ignore God like this week? How much time did I really devote and give to him? You know, it's almost like if in a relationship, when you call somebody and they don't answer and it goes to voicemail, or you know, you don't see them and you're thinking, you know, is something wrong? And sometimes I think that God may feel that way about us. It's like, wow, you know, they're not calling, they're not talking to me. We kind of ignore, and sometimes we use him kind of like in an emergency situation. So we kind of only call on him when we're really in need and in crisis. And so we want to, again, to develop a relationship that is ongoing. Amen. So we want to be able to do that as we do so. So that's a blessing. So that is our lesson. Let me give you some practical points. And then, God, we're doing really good on time today. Amen. Amen. So let me get some practical points that we want to walk away with in today's lesson. And it says here, God requires order and reverence from those who worship him. Amen. So we want to worship God in spirit and in truth, and we want to do so reverently. And that means with all seriousness in mind. It's something that we ought to take, not take lightly, but we do it in a way that has order and has reverence. Amen. When we worship God. Amen. Number two, godly leadership relies on God's word, not human wisdom. Amen. And so in terms of leadership, godly leadership relies on the word of God, God's word, and not on our own wisdom. Our minds are way too shallow or way too frail to really take on, you know, the leadership that God requires. And so we've got to depend on him to give us instruction, depend on him to do so. All right. Number three, sacrificial gifts and offerings demonstrate a dependence on God and show that we recognize the price we have been bought with. Amen. And so we talked about how animals were sacrificed. And again, let me emphasize again, that is not the case anymore. Because why? Because Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice. And so we thank, and we just ought to thank and praise God for his giving his life. And again, take it personal, y'all. Take it personal that think about your name, that he was calling my name out so that he was thinking about me. He was doing so that I might, that Steve Gardner. So put your own name in it. Amen. That he was doing so. Amen. Love that. And again, our obedience to God's instructions demonstrate our faith in him. And we want to be obedient to God, not that it's something like, oh, I gotta be obedient, but we ought to do so because we love him, because we know that it pleases him. And so I get excited to know when God is pleased with me. And I also, you know, I'm very disappointed at myself many times when I know that God isn't pleased. And so I just thank God for you know, repentance and forgiveness of sin, because I want to please God. I want God to be pleased with me. And when he thinks about me, I want him to be pleased with me. And so it's something that we kind of have to think about, is I want to be able to trust and obey him and do it so because I love him. Do so. When Brianna was little, Brianna is my daughter, for those of you, when I say Brianna, she used to always, if she would do something and I would go, she goes, Daddy, are you disappointed in me? And if I said yes, oh, that would just tear her up. Oh, she just did not want to disappoint her dad. Listen, you all, I don't want to disappoint my father. I don't want God to be disappointed in me. And so I want him to be pleased with me. And the good news is, just like I said, well, baby, Daddy forgives you. Daddy's, you know, then she'd ask me about four or five times, are you just, you still disappointed? I said, no, Daddy's not disappointed. Isn't that just like God does us? That he allows us to come to him even when we've done wrong. He allows us to come and say, Father, please forgive me. And how wonderful it feels to know that God forgives us and loves us. And like I said, even when we've done wrong. Amen. So that, let me thank you for that. Number five, almost through. In worship and in prayer, we must resist the temptation to bring God down to our level. Amen. We just want to stay, Lord, help me to worship you in a way that references you and adores you in all that we do. All right? Listen, right worship prepares God's people for fellowship with him. Amen. So it prepares his people. So in this particular lesson, God confirms his covenant with the children of Israel. And folks, for today, think about how we have to ask God, Lord, help me to obey your word. Help me to read it. Help me to apply it, that I might do what is pleasing in thy sight. We want to please God. And so our lesson on this unit on instruction is another piece that kind of really capsulizes this particular unit. We've been dealing with provision. We've been dealing with instruction. And next unit, next month in November, we're going to be dealing with correction. Amen. Next week's lesson is going to be entitled, God Meets Moses Alone. Amen. God Meets Moses Alone. Boy. So that's going to be our lesson for next week. Speaking of next week, you know what next week is? If the Lord says the same, on Saturday, October 24th, Brother Gardner will be 61 years old. Hey, man. I know you're saying, Brother Gardner, I mean, look at this, was 61. Looks like. Lord, thank you, though. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. But yes, thank you. Thank you all so very much. Listen, I have one last song because y'all thought I wasn't going to play my tambourine, right? You all thought you was going to get away with Brother Gardner not playing his tambourine. That is not about to happen. We thank you for another Sunday morning. So after my song, well, I'll give a couple of more announcements, and then we have a little break before our 10 o'clock watch party. And then I'm trying to remember what Sunday it is that we're going to have a gospel DJ by DJ Okima. Amen. And so I'm not sure if it's today. I can't remember, but I know it's coming up. So let me say that. All right, let me get ready to play this. Let me also say, I know as the holidays approach, I know many of you are you know, if you need holiday kind of gift items, just hit me up and I will have some great gift items available through Steve's Mobile Bible Bookstore. Amen. And so please, ma'am, please, sir, I'll be happy to come to you and let you shop in a safe, comfortable environment, or I'll make some arrangements to be somewhere to be able to do so. Okay, listen, did I tell y'all how much I love y'all? I really appreciate you all just for tuning in each Sunday morning. I don't take it for granted. I want to thank you all for all of your suggestions. But here is my next song that I love, and it's by the great Yolanda Adams. It's an old one. This is when Yolanda was with the Southeast Choir way back in the day, before she became like Yolanda Adams. But you know, this is when she was singing with a community choir, and I love this song. And here we go.
Why build a pillow tower for nasal congestion?
Play after this. Okay, let me kind of get this done first. This is a great song, you all. And I know I say that about every song, but I like the song a lot. Here we come. And here we go. I let the song play first. Next Sunday, October 25th at 11. Thank you. Blessed Sunday. Again, remember, immediately following, we've got about 9 minutes before the Berkeley Mount Zion watch party or next service with our none other than our own pastor teacher, Reverend Brian D. Hunter. I understand that next Sunday, October 25th, following the 10 o'clock service at 11 o'clock, Sister Okima is going to have her praise party. Amen. Some great, great, great music. Amen. So we look forward to that. Again, let me remind folks to please, please, ma'am, please, sir, please vote. Please vote. Please vote. Please vote. If you don't vote, don't complain. Amen. And then if you need someone to take your ballot to the mailbox, you may call the church and someone will see to it that they come up and pick up your mail, pick up your ballot and see to it that it is mailed and delivered. Amen. Finally, folks, please continue to be safe. Wear your mask, do your social distancing, wash your hands. Do all those things that keep you safe. Amen. We want to have you around for as long as we can. And so we want to do our very best to make sure that you practice those things. Do your part of the agreement. Amen. That's a COVID covenant. Do your part. Amen. And wear your mask and wash your hands and be safe. Those things will help kind of help you to be safe. Have a wonderful, wonderful Sunday. The weather has been great. Amen. We've had some wonderful, beautiful, beautiful weather. Be safe. Just know that I love you, but most importantly, God loves you. Amen. And because of that, he has a plan for your life. Amen. So keep that in mind. So listen, you've got about 7 minutes. I'm going to go ahead and sign off, allow you all to have a little recess before our next session. And thank you all. I'm getting better with the tambourine. I'm in Dianette Jones School of Tambourine. So I'm kind of almost graduated in the class. Amen. Listen, have a great, great Sunday. And Be safe out there, folks, okay? All right, signing off, and get you some coffee before our next service, and have a great, great Sunday. All right, take care, y'all.